Good morning and a very happy Sabbath to each one of you. We take this opportunity to welcome our regular members as well as visitors that are with us. And we don't want to forget those that are joining us online. We invite all to participate in this worship service and gain a blessing out of this. This is a beautiful spring showery morning when all nature is waking up to praise God, and in the process inviting us to follow suit. And we have a few announcements to be made today. There's going to be a fellowship meal, potluck, I think Italian style, soon after the service. All are invited. Also, there is no midweek meeting. The series has been concluded, so until further notice, there will be no midweek meetings. Okay. I guess that's all I have. Paul Gensler has an announcement about the upcoming social, I guess. And Dr. Gensler has something after that.
So tomorrow at 3 o'clock, there is a painting social. And I brought some of my painting supplies here. Brought a roller. I think Jocelyn is in charge. This is what I need? I don't need this. It's too big. That one's too big, apparently. So I brought some other stuff here, too. How about that? Will that work? I've got one more. How about that? Getting closer? You're going to bring all the painting supplies. So I don't need to bring any painting supplies. Okay. Paint clothes. Okay. So, tomorrow at 3 o'clock, we have a painting social. It is going to be led and directed by Jocelyn, who, if you don't already know this, is a very good artist. So bring some clothes you don't mind getting some paint on. Bring a smile. Bring a friend. And make sure that you sign up on the sign-up sheet that is out on the bulletin board. Now, I have also been informed that there is going to be a $15 fee to help cover all those painting supplies that are being provided. But show up and have a great time, okay? 3 o'clock. Heather?
Good morning, everyone. So this summer, our church is again hosting another vacation Bible school, and it's going to be from June 20 through 24, from 6 to 8 p.m. The program is aimed at children ages 5 to 12, and it's going to be a summer camp theme in the mountains. Though for this program to be a success, I need help from all of you. If not all of you, most of you, whoever is willing to help, I would love to have your assistance. So we need help with camp counselors. These are the people who will guide the children from station to station. And so these people, they don't, if you're a person who kind of likes to be behind the scenes and, you know, is a little bit more shy or whatnot, this person is just mostly just taking care of the children, supervising the children, just making sure they go from station to station. We also need camp leaders. These are the leaders who will be in charge of one of the five different stations. So the different stations is the Bible story station, snack station, the game station, crafts, and then there's a science station. This person has a little bit more responsibilities. But don't worry, there is a guidebook for you that you could follow, and it tells you exactly what you need to say And I could give this to you ahead of time so that you can, you know, prep if you need to. So I will be having a meeting next Sabbath right after church in the fellowship hall. So if this is something that you guys would love to volunteer with, love to help with, and want to just, or even if you just want to learn a little bit more about it, and if you're not sure, come to the meeting. I'll have more information about it. We also need help with people who are behind the scenes. So people that aren't necessarily going to come during that week, but is willing to help prep crafts ahead of time, prep bags ahead of time. And so any kind of help we could use. So please come next Sabbath, and then right after church, we'll meet in the fellowship hall. Thank you.
So if I understand correctly, next Sabbath after church, everybody in this congregation is going to get up and go right through that door and become a part of this meeting. Is that correct?
Sure.
Okay, very good. You know your marching orders for next Sabbath. You know what's going to happen. Okay, how many of you like a progress report? Did any of you know that there's something happening? Let me ask you a question. Is something happening in our church right now? Now, I bet if I asked what is happening, I could get a whole variety of answers here. So let me ask you, how many of you are aware of the fact that we have a new handicap bathroom? How many of you have stuck your face head in there and taken a look? I mean, it is like Marriott Hotel quality. I mean, it looks amazing. It's fantastic. Now, guess what? That's only phase one. We got some more projects coming along. In fact, the other two bathrooms are going to go through the same renovation here in the next 2 months thereabouts. In fact, the goal is to have them done by VBS. Do you think that can happen? All right, that's our goal. Now, just to give you a little update as to where we are, about 2 months ago, we talked about the fact that this congregation needs to raise about $92,000+ to help contribute to this project. And I want you to know that to date, already, $30,000 of that has come in. Praise the Lord. Okay? We're a third of the way through, and we only have gone 2 months. And this was going to be a how long project? 2 years. So for those of you who have not gotten out your paper and pencil and done a little figuring and started planning as to what you're going to make in relationship to the upkeep of this project, you have lots of time to still become a part of this. And I want to encourage you to put yourself in a place where God can bless you by you being a blessing to others. And this is one of those ways. And I pray that God will bless every one of you as you participate in this project. Thank you very much.
Our call to worship this morning is taken from the book of Psalms. And Psalms is a collocation of various poems, praise, and devotional poems. They're all put together, and each one, there are five of them, each one ends with a doxology or a statement of praise. Now, the last section, or the last book, from about 107 Psalm to 150, they call, this is the last one, and 150 is called the doxology of doxologies. That means from the start to the finish, verse 1 up to 6, it's all praise. And we're going to just read the first and the last verses of Psalm 150. Praise ye the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, raise him in the firmament of his power. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, we come to your sanctuary this Sabbath morning with praise and thanksgiving, because you, O Lord, is the sanctuary where you have laid the foundation of our salvation. Now accept our praise, our thanksgiving, and our worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now we'll have the congregation's musical praise. You too. Okay.
Good morning. Our first song today will be This Is My Father's World, number 92 in your hymnal.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, my rest in the fold of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, his hand the wanderers draw. This is my Father's world, the
Lord God, make them all.
our opening song. Number 88, I Sing the Mighty Power of God. Number 88 in your hymnal.
It's now time for us to worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Will the deacons please come forward? And the offering today is going to be for disaster and famine relief. And we'll have a prayer before we start collecting the offering. Father in heaven, we give thee, but thine own, whate'er the gift may be, all that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen. Thank you. be ready for the children's story? Children's story? Okay, okay. Now it's time for our children's story, and some of these kids must be there, I think. Amy Carter is going to give us the children's story.
So I'm talking to the children up here. All righty. Very good. Well, happy Sabbath. That was beautiful, by the way. It's fun to hear the bells again. My kids played bells. How many of you have flown a kite before? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You guys can sit right here. Few of you? Well, in my family, flying kites is a big deal. Mr. Carter has made sure that all of our kids have learned how to fly kites because that's actually one of his hobbies. Loves to fly kites. And do you have a picture, Roger? Here's a picture of our children. They all got their first kites between the ages of 3 and 5, and they still have those kites. Those are their very first kites, Kyle and Jocelyn and Zachy. Well, flying kites is a lot of fun. It makes people happy. It's challenging. And you can feel free. Who's ever felt like they'd like to fly? As a kid, I wanted to fly. Did you ever feel like flying? Being free above the sky, looking down on the earth? I used to dream about flying, playing tag as a kid, and I could fly, and none of the kids in class could fly, but I could. So I could get away all the time. Do you ever use your imagination like that? Well, I did. I always wanted to fly. In our lives with Jesus, we have a lot in common with kites. And one day I really believe that we are going to fly up in heaven, one way or the other. We're going to get to go from one planet to another and go all over the place and visit people in some way of flying. God's going to make it so we can do that. Such a cool feeling, I know. Let's see, how does a kite stay up? So I don't have a string on this kite, but a kite stays up by going through the air, and the wind is pushing through, pushing on it. So that is called the pressure that is against it is the force and the lift that lifts it up. But then you also have another force, and that's the string pulling on it, and that's the drag. So it takes both of those things to keep the kite up, keep it up in the sky. Now, let's look at a kite. The kite has a canvas. This is this part of it. And it also has the body, it's a canvas, and then it has its strong two big sticks in it. And if you look at the sticks, what shape do you see? I heard it in the audience. Yeah, you see a cross. You see that? A cross. Now let's pretend we're a kite. Gotta use our imagination again. If you were a kite, and you were the canvas, and the cross was Jesus. Do we need Jesus in our lives? Yeah, we can stay together. If we have Jesus with us and we are with him, he's going to help us fly higher, right? Now, what is this called? What's this part called? Oops, I hit somebody. This is the tail. A kite has a tail so it doesn't go all squirrely all over the place. It helps it stay up in the air, keeps it steady. So the tail is kind of like having faith. Faith. We need faith to keep us connected with Jesus. And so the tail is like faith. And when we read God's word, we don't have to be afraid of spiraling out of control. We keep ourselves, keep our faith in Jesus. What else is on a kite? Let's see. What is it that keeps that kite up in the air?
Wind.
The wind. You have all the answers, my friend. The wind keeps the kite up in the air. So the wind is kind of like the Holy Spirit. You can't see it. You can't see him. But it keeps you afloat. And it keeps you closer to Jesus. And when life gets you down, the Holy Spirit is there, keeping you up, up in the air. When do you most see a kite? Do you see it when it's on the ground? When do you see a kite? When it's way up in the sky. Everyone can see it flying around. Makes you happy when you see a kite flying. People will smile at you too when you have the Holy Spirit taking you where God wants you to go, keeping him in your life. All right, now I don't have what's attached to this, but what do you attach to this? A rope or a string, correct? So here's a string. Here's the string. And is it a big string? It's a pretty thin one, isn't it? But this thin string can hold that kite and keep it up way up high in the air. Now, if the string breaks, what happens to the kite? It flies away, and then what happens? It crashes hard. That's right. It crashes hard to the ground. Well, the string that you're holding on to is kind of like God. God's holding on. God is like the string. And it seems like when we pray, and God is so far away, like a speck up there, and that string is so thin, it feels like it's such a tiny connection. What? We can feel that tug. We can feel that tug of God. He's holding on to us, and he will never let go. He will never let go of us. His connection is strong. In Psalms 37:34, it says, "People may stumble, but the Lord holds them by their hand, and he does not let go." God does not let go of us. The Lord knows where we are in our lives. He knows when to pull us in, to let us go. And he is the balance of our cross and our tail, our faith, and the wind, the Holy Spirit in himself. And someday, Jesus is going to reel us in, and we're going to get to fly away to heaven with him. Who wants to be a kite and fly away with Jesus someday? Yeah, I do too. I can't wait for that day. So keep Jesus with you so you guys can fly high, okay? All right, you can go to your seats. Thanks for listening. Oh, I have a color sheet if you guys want one. I'm going to pick out a color sheet. Thank you.
It's so wonderful to see some of the younger members of our congregation to be so actively participating in our worship services. This morning we have two of the Amarillo girls that are going to be doing the scripture reading and the prayer. They gave me the names, Annalie and Sarahi. I'm yet to figure out who is who in this one, but they'll be doing the scripture reading and the congregational prayer.
Today's scripture is found in James 5, 7 through 8. James 5, 7 through 8 says, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near." Please kneel with me if you are able. Dear Jesus, thank you that we're able to worship together. Please be with those who weren't able to be here today. Take care of those in Ukraine, families that are being split up. Be with the pastor today as he preaches your word, and may our hearts be open to understand the message. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Wasn't that good? The Albany Youth Bells. And you know, with every time that they've been performing, they were getting better and better and better. Amen?
Amen.
I am so proud of our young people, aren't you? Things that they're doing, the music and all the various activities. Thank you so much, Annalie, Sarahi, for the scripture and prayer today, and all of you young people sharing your talents for the Lord. That is so incredible. Thank you so, so very much. And also the things that are happening with our youth club. You know, we've got a youth club going. And today, this afternoon, at about 1:30, Tim tells me, and Sunny, thank you for your leadership as well, Sunny and Tim Arakawa. And they're going to have showing a video, I understand, another segment of Tell It to the World, which is the history of a pioneer work, the history of the Advent movement. And if you want to come and join the youth at about 1:30, I think they would be okay with that. See that segment, learn more of the history, the wonderful, amazing history of the Advent movement. I know that you will be blessed by that. So as we begin our message today, with these thoughts introductory, the National Weather Service, Portland recorded that there was some 5.73 inches of rain throughout the month at the Portland International Airport, putting 2022 in the record books as for all-time April precipitation. The record follows a historically dry April for the Rose City. Last year, in 2021, not only did the city see the driest April on record since 1941, it was also the fifth warmest on record. Total rainfall came to 0.39 inches. But Portland's average rainfall for April, 2.89 inches. The record precipitation for 2022 was aided by a rare snowstorm early in the month, perhaps. But below, I want us to see here the top five. The top five, I don't know why you can see that on the screen. But in 1955, 4.7 inches in April, 2011, 5.04, 1996, 5.12, 1993, 5.26, and 2022, 5.73 inches. And May, what about May? May is shaping up to be wetter than usual, perhaps, as well. This morning, I would like us to consider the significance of the greatest rainfall ever recorded in human history, and another counterpart considered for our day. But before we begin, I'd like us to bow our heads as we seek the Lord in prayer. Oh, Father, help us to grasp the significance of rain in Scripture record. And may we see the significance for our day. We pray these things. In Jesus' name, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be truly be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. It is in his name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen and amen. And so, every pound of the hammer, every pound of the hammer, which drove a nail through the safely fresh cut gopher wood, was in perfect timing with the heart of Noah, as if it were pounding with a driving love for lost souls. Wiping the sweat from his brow, he could see in the distance neighbors, acquaintances that had come to watch, to witness, and yes, even to ridicule, and to spread the rumor about his clever invention and his unbelievably fantasy of what? A global flood that would destroy the earth. No doubt Noah and his family would have scoffed at and would have been written off by many as, could we call them the rainy day cult? the rainy day cult. And despite this, Noah spent year after year working and laboring. You see, Methuselah and his sons would also lend their strength to the construction of this great ark, which would be, my friends, the only means of salvation for the people who lived just before the flood. But Noah didn't build only. While he strained his frame to manufacture a massive ship, he lifted his passionate voice to call all those who would receive the message of God's eternal love and salvation to do what? Prepare themselves to enter into that ark. You see, Noah was a preacher. Noah was a preacher of righteousness. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 tells us. And while he prepared and while he preached, as he built, he was doing something. He was proclaiming something. He was broadcasting something. What was that? The gospel message. In that beautiful yet lonely setting was heard the sound of erecting, not only erecting, but evangelizing. Not only of hewing, but of homily that went on along with it. Now imagine Noah preaching a message to that civilization of intellectual giants. Weren't they intellectual? Were they giants? I mean, people back in that day lived how long, young people? 100, 200, 300, even up to 800, even up to 900 years of age. They were giants. They were great historians. They were great scientists. They were philosophers and psychologists and sociologists trying to tell them that he was building a boat. It was going to rain. Now that must have gone over with those intellectuals of the day like a lead balloon. They said, "Rain? What is rain, you crazy old man? Rainy day cult. You mean water is going to fall from heaven? Is that right? Prove it." And I can imagine them saying, the scientists, well, the scientists are supposed to be coming up here. Let's see, we got this here. Okay, the scientist said, "It's never rained before. That is what? Unscientific." The historians may have been saying something like this: "There's no record of it ever having rained before." You see, they never saw that happening before. There were the theologians. The theologians may have been saying something like this: "Oh God, God is a God of love. He would never destroy his creatures. Besides, a flood would be a what? Miracle. And miracles just don't exist." Well, maybe the psychologists were saying this: "Noah, you're confusing reality with fantasy. You're having an imaginary delusion and needed to be treated psychologically. Why don't you just take a pill?" Wow. I can imagine the sociologist saying something like this: "Now, this is a dangerous guy. He could cause an upheaval in society." I can imagine the philosopher saying this: "Well, you know," scratching their beards, "well, you know, if Noah wants to believe that, well, that's fine. That's his truth. If someone wants to believe something else, well, that's okay for them to believe that." But God calls Noah, my friends. And Noah preaches for how long, young people? 120 years. The Holy Spirit accompanies the message of Noah to the world. His work is one of the most impressive structures that had ever been assembled before, not to exceed his labor of love for those people. But Noah does not want to wait. Noah, this rainy day preacher, unto the first drop of rain fell upon the lush vegetation and watered the soil. He does not wait. A late invitation was not to be given. Before the winds blew and the fountains of the deep broke forth and marked the end of a generation, there was to be a call to every unbeliever to repent and be converted. That's why the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, by faith Noah, warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, what did he do? Build that ark. What was it to do? Save his family and anyone else who would enter the ark that day. And my friends, you know the story. You know the story. It did rain. It did rain. It rained. Rain. Rain. And rain. For 40 days and 40 days. Imagine what that must have been like. Something like you never saw or heard. So the Bible says, just as it was in the days of Noah, so also it will be when? In the days of the Son of Man. In the days of the Son of Man. Sometimes we think about the wickedness that was there in Noah's day. As it was the wickedness in Noah's day, so it will be in the days of the Son of Man. But what about the other aspects of the days of Noah? I want us to think about that. Another aspect of the days of Noah. A call was given and rain, what? Fell. A call was given and a rain fell. I want us to think about that this morning, my friends. Because there is another rain coming. Not a rain to bring the judgment of God upon our world, but a rain that will help to finish the work of God here on this earth. The rain will fall again. As it was in the days of Noah, the rains will fall again. The rainfall which God wants to give in the end is different than the stormy torrents that flooded the world some 4,500 years ago, while the outpouring of precipitation in Noah's day completely wiped off life on earth, the outpouring of the holy rain in the last days is sent to revive the spiritual lives of God's people here on this earth. The scripture has given us the promise of rain. I want us to focus on this just for a few moments remaining this morning. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit without measure. And I so appreciated that illustration of the cross and that in that kite, the cross and the string representing God, and then the wind in that kite representing the power of God's Holy Spirit. So the promise of rain, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit without measure. The Bible says this in Isaiah chapter 44, verse 3. For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. Wow. God's going to do that? Amen. As the rain fell in the days of Noah, in a bad way, to bring judgment, there's going to be another rain at the end of time that's going to be a rain of revival, a revival of the Spirit, a revival that is seen. Early rain and latter rain. Early rain or former rain and latter rain. Early rain that would bring the seed, start getting that going, getting it to grow, and the latter rain that would bring it finally and fully to maturity of a harvest. And my friends, when Jesus comes, he's coming, the sound of the trumpet, but also he's going to have in his hand a sharp sickle. What is he doing with that sickle? to harvest the grain. What is that grain? The harvest? People. To harvest a world at the end of time when Jesus comes. And he will do that through the latter rain of his Spirit. Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 13 records this. So if you faithfully obey the commands I am giving you today, to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, then I will send what? I will send rain. Rain on your land in its season, both the autumn, the early, and the spring, the latter rains, kind of that's the way it was over there in the Middle East, so that you may gather your grain, new wine, and oil. I will provide grass in the fields for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. So he says, last day, rainy day, called people. It's coming. God wants to give it in marked manner. I want to be ready for it, don't you? The latter rain, falling near the close of the season, ripened the grain, preparing it for the sickle. And Jesus is coming soon. Just as the literal rain prepared the crops for harvest, God uses them as an illustration of the work of the Holy Spirit beforehand. The dew and the rain given beforehand to cause the seed to germinate and then to ripen this harvest. So the Holy Spirit is to carry forward a work of spiritual growth from one stage of development to another stage, preparing for that latter rain. Hosea, that little-known prophet, writes in two places this idea. Let us know, let us pursue the knowledge of the Lord. His going forth is established as the morning. He will come to us like the rain, like the latter and former rain. He will come to us. But what should we do? Let's acknowledge the Lord. Amen? We need to acknowledge the Lord. God, you exist. God, you're calling, you're making a call, an appeal, just like Noah did for 120 years on this earth. There's a last day movement, people who are calling. It's an everlasting gospel message. It's proclaimed with a loud voice. His going forth is established as the morning. He will come to us like the rain, the latter and the former rain on the earth. That little prophet Hosea, that little book also records these words. Sow for yourselves righteousness. Reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground or the untilled ground. Break it up, for it is time to seek the Lord. My friends, if ever there was a time to seek the Lord, isn't it now, today? In this day and age in which we're living, with all these things going on around us, is this the time when we should seek the Lord until he comes and rains righteousness on you? Oh, how our world needs righteousness, don't we? What's righteousness? Right doing, right living. Is the world living right today? If ever there was a time, the world needs right living, right doing, right thinking, right acting, right being. It is the days in which we're living today, my friends. And so when the day of Pentecost was fully come, the early Christian church quoted from this particular passage in Joel. It was Peter. It was on the day of Pentecost. He quoted this passage is from Joel chapter 2, verse 23. He has given you the former and latter rain. He will cause rain to come down for you, the former rain and the latter rain. And so when we come to the book of Acts, this passage of Joel is again quoted. The early Christian church, the time of Pentecost, the Bible says in Acts chapter 2, read it. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, And it says in that chapter, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit. He poured out that which you now see and hear. What happened? What happened in that early rain experience of the early Christian church? God gave them the Holy Spirit in marked manner. And what did they do? They went around speaking tongues. What were those tongues? Gibberish? No, it was tongues that every man heard them speak in their own tongue. There were people from all different parts of the world, and God gave them the special endowment of the Spirit so that when they preached the message, everyone heard in their own tongue the words of God. And as a result, there was a great revival that took place in the then known Christian world. And many people were baptized. And the Bible says in Acts chapter 2 that as many as what? 3,000 people were baptized in how, what period of time? One single day. Day of Pentecost. The early rain. The early rain and what it did in the early Christian church. My friends, there again will be seen a similar experience in the end of time. The Bible says, I will pour out my Spirit. And it shall come to pass afterward, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also on my maidservants and on my manservants and on my maidservants, I will pour out my Spirit in those days. I believe a beginning of latter rain power came in the early Advent experience, going to be replicated again in a greater way. We're coming closer, ever closer to the end of time. They got together. They opened their Bibles. They sought for truth. They loved the Word of God. They wanted to be ready for the second coming of Jesus. Are we today with that same fervor, same passion, that same intensity, that same desire, that same love for God as our early pioneers who were given the message, who understood more as the Bible was being unfolded to them, as the book of Daniel was being unsealed in the latter days. The book of Daniel said, the Bible said it would be understood that was taking place. They studied Daniel and the books of Daniel, the book of Revelation, and they came to Revelation chapter 14. And they read there, oh, these are must be important messages, because what are these? These are three angels. They're flying in mid-heaven with a loud voice talking about the everlasting gospel. They were reading this chapter, Revelation 14, verse 6. I saw another angel flying in mid-air. He had the eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on the earth. To live on the earth, saying a loud voice, the hour of his judgment has come. A judgment hour message. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Why? Because the hour of God's judgment is here. Jesus is coming soon. Oh, come on, you rainy day cultists, you. What are you talking about? Jesus coming soon. Come on, everything continues on as it was from the beginning of creation. People are still marrying each other. People are eating and drinking. People are doing their things every day. They're going to work. They're coming home. They're watching television. They're going to the movies or whatever they want to do. Jesus isn't coming. Listen to this quote. Many will be seeing, hurrying here and there, constrained by the Spirit of God to bring the light to others. The truth, the Word of God is a fire in their bones, filling them with a burning desire to enlighten those who sit in darkness. Notice what it says, young people. Children are impelled. Young people are going to get into the action. Children are impelled by the Spirit to go forth and declare the message from heaven. The Spirit is poured out upon all who yield to its promptings. They declare the truth with the might of the Spirit's power. Multitudes will receive the faith and join the armies of the Lord. Wow. Powerful. That's why we believe in Christian education. Because it's got to be a work of young people coming on board here. It's clear that we must be prepared individually and as a people for the heavenly shower of love and power. But by His grace, we should be putting aside sin, pride, worldliness, addictions, habits, everything out of order with the Word of God. Isn't that true? Must put all of that aside. Want to get ready for the rain. Imperative that as this happens, on a personal and a corporate level, these works are similar to the building of the ark in Noah's day. He did not just stand idly by there waiting for the rain to fall. He was actively involved in preparation. Noah and his family for 120 years used all of their talents, all of their resources. They invested everything they had into the building of that thing. And all of this is we are all to do in preparation for the prophetic downpour of the Spirit of God. When the church has become living, working churches. That's what I want our church to be. You? How about you? Our church. Our church. God's church. A living, working church. The Holy Spirit will be given an answer to their sincere request. They will then plead with souls with an earnestness that cannot be repulsed. Then the windows of heaven will be open for the showers of the latter rain. Like Noah did. We are to prepare an ark for the souls. An ark of our souls, searching our hearts in prayer, in preaching, in proclaiming the message, in living the lives, in giving those Bible studies, in sharing our witness with other people as we come together for midweek prayer meetings, as we study the scripture together. We must not forget to broadcast the gospel message. It is our work, the salvation of people, that gives evidence of our faith in the latter rain and proof to God that we even dare to ask for the power for a finished work. Oh God, why don't you come? Oh God, finish the work. Says to you and to me today, I want to finish the work. I want my Holy Spirit to be in you. I'm willing to pour out my Spirit without measure. Are you ready? How interesting it is that God first spoke, first destroyed the world. How did He destroy the world first? With water. And then consumed the early church members in the upper room with tongs of fire. And now in our day, God will destroy the world, the Bible says in the book of Revelation, with fire. But He's going to refresh the earth with water. See that? See that? The baptism of the Holy Spirit. Our salvation depends on this preparatory work, on becoming no less our day, no less evil than before the flood. Our day, the media, the scenes of pleasure, the conditions of homes and society today, all giving testimony that something is about to give. Something is about to happen, my friends. We must continue to work on behalf of fallen humanity with increased effort before the door of the ark closes. Because there is coming a day soon when probation will close. When the ark of that door of that ark closed, was it then a second time to be saved? Oh God, Mr. Noah, would you please, I want to get in after all. Would you please open that door? What we wait for is the power to work on behalf of fallen humanity with increased effort before the door of the ark closes and seals in those who will be saved when probation's door closes. Our pioneers saw the need to preach the three angels' messages as present truth. What we wait for is the power to finish what we have been commissioned to do from our very beginning. And so Christ has given us a sacred charge. Every member should be a channel through which God can communicate to the world the treasure of his grace, the unsearchable riches of Christ. There is nothing the Savior desires so much as agents who will represent to the world his spirit and his character. There is nothing that the world needs so much as a manifestation through humanity of the Savior's love. All heaven is waiting for men and women, boys and girls, young people, youth, through which God can reveal the power of Christianity. The question is this: will we be aqueducts through which the rains will flow? We need now a living experience in the school of Christ, that we may mingle among people, that we may win them to Jesus Christ as we pray going forth. Lord, we need the rain. Send us. Send us your gospel rain.
Join us in standing. We're going to sing our closing song, Showers of Blessing.
us.
We want to be ready. Let the rains fall. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.